Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. As a result of membership change, our first agenda item is a declaration of interest. We repeat our thanks to Ms. Weber for her contribution to the committee. And this morning we are joined by Maurice Golden. So, Mr. Golden, I welcome you to the committee. We look forward to working with you and invite you to make a declaration of interest.
Thanks, convener. Delighted to be here. Just to make everyone aware, I attended, particularly given today's session, I attended a trip to Nepal with Kate Forbes in the last session of Parliament, which was sponsored by Tier Fund, to look at human trafficking and tackling climate justice.
Thank you very much. We now move to agenda item two, which is a decision on taking business in private. Are members of invited to decide to the consideration of evidence should be taken at agenda item five in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Can we agree that for future meetings too? Thank you. We now move to agenda item three, which is as part of our international development work and in the run-up to COP26, we're looking at climate justice. This will be a one-off session and the committee will hear from two panels this morning. And can I first welcome Jamie Livingston, Head of Oxfam Scotland, Carolyn Sawyers, Acting Chief Executive at the Cora Foundation, and Chris Hegarty, Senior Advisor for Christian Aid Scotland. Good morning to you all. We are going to move straight to questions this morning, and I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron to open questions on behalf of the committee.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Great to see you all. I'd like to ask a very general question around the general central principles of climate justice, one of which is protecting and respecting human rights. And as ever, there's a tension between the important principle and then its everyday application in practice. And in terms of practical application, and more importantly, enforcement of human rights, how do we overcome the challenges around protecting human rights when across the world different thresholds and standards are applied?
I'll go to Mr. Livingston first for that. Thanks. Is Mr. Livingston there? Can the panel hear us?
Yes. Can you hear me okay?
We can. Did you hear our question?
You can.
Yeah, that's great.
I did. Thank you very much. I think it's a really important question. I mean, part of that solution to that is about setting the highest possible standards within your own powers. Of course, here in Scotland, there has been a large and substantial focus on human rights and trying to integrate human rights into Scots law. So when I think, for example, of things like the right to food, obviously that's being denied to very many people around the world, but here in Scotland we also have issues with people being able to access food, and that's why activities to try to integrate human rights into Scots law and give life to them in Scotland is so important, because if we do that, then we can credibly champion human rights internationally. And in relation to climate justice specifically, I've seen myself the interaction between the climate crisis and the denial of human rights internationally. You know, sometimes when we talk about climate justice, it can seem very theoretical, but it's very far from that. And certainly in 2016, I travelled to Malawi and I saw the impact of the food crisis there, driven by drought. I met families who literally had no clue where the next meal was coming from. And when you speak to people like that, human rights frameworks and standards seem like a very distant prospect. So Scotland can support and do support, and in that case, we're supporting those individuals to access their right to food. But we need to get the framework right in Scotland too, so that we can do that work credibly.
Can I invite Ms. Sawyers? Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you. And
echo a lot of what Jamie's already said. Obviously, our role here in, as Cora Foundation is as a manager and a grant manager on behalf of the Scottish Government around the Climate Justice Innovation Fund. And so my contribution really is based on what we are hearing from grant holders, what we're hearing from organisations in partner countries around these issues. Really strongly echo what Jamie said about setting our own standards and our own approach here in Scotland. You know, for us, of course, this starts, I suppose, from the responsibilities that we bear as a country that's benefited most, I suppose, from industrialisation over its periods and therefore contributing most to climate change. So, you know, as we hold that kind of moral responsibility, it feels to me like our kind of push to act, you know, is extremely strong. We very strongly welcome the human rights framework in Scotland, and as Jamie set out, that really is the basis, I suppose, for our actions elsewhere as well.
And Mr. Hegarty.
Yes, good morning. I'm afraid I missed the first part of the question and the first part of Jamie's answer due to, I think, a connectivity issue. But sorry, I can't really contribute on this one.
The question was basically how do we overcome the challenges around the world in terms of protecting human rights when internationally different thresholds and standards are applied. And I think, you know, for example, the right to food is a good one. How do we make the right to food mean something that can be enforced and applied internationally?
Mr. Hegarty, are you able to hear
I'm
us?
Sorry. Mm-hmm.
I think there's an issue. I wonder if maybe we could switch Mr. Hegarty's screen off and perhaps he would be able to just have audio to see if that's any better. Can you still hear us, Mr. Hegarty? Is Mr. Hegarty there? I think we're going to have to try and get Mr. Hegarty on boarded again, and I'll come back to Donald for a supplementary question.
Yeah, I suppose it's the same question I've just asked Mr. Hegarty, which is just to drill down, and I fully acknowledge the comments made already about what Scotland is doing in terms of human rights and the frameworks here. But I suppose the question is, how do we make something like the right to food mean something internationally in developing countries, so that it is something that can be relied upon by individuals and enforced? I just wonder if you've got any observations about that.
Mr. Livingstone?
Thank you for taking me off mute. Obviously, human rights are universal, and Scotland and the UK have an obligation to hold other countries to account for the delivery of those human rights. But alongside that, we need to do what's within our gift to support their delivery. So I guess one of the important things, as well as demonstrating our commitment to those human rights at home, is about supporting their implementation and realisation internationally. And that's where our international development contribution is so important. And the UK and indeed Scotland have a good and strong track record on development assistance. Of course, we voiced concern recently around the cuts to overseas development assistance at UK level, which we think have come at the wrong time and will result in more people being denied their human right to food. So in that regard, we would of course urge all rich developed countries to fulfil their commitments to 0.7% of aid, and particularly in the course, in the context of COVID, that is applying additional financial pressures on very many countries, on top of the pre-existing development challenges, and indeed on top of the new additional challenges created by the climate crisis, that overseas development assistance is even more important. So I think we need to get our own house in order, realise the right to food here in the UK in the context in which far too many people are relying on food banks because of facing income crisis, but doing what we can internationally to hold other countries to account for the realisation of the right to food and supporting the delivery of that important principle through our overseas development assistance.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Ms. Sawyers, I think Mr. Cameron's got a supplementary
it's fine.
Oh, is it okay? So I'll bring in Ms. Sawyers and then I'll come back. Thanks. Ms. Sawyers?
Thank you. And so just drilling down into that as the question asks, I think, again, to reinforce the points about recognising our own responsibilities, Scotland modelling what's needed, and that feels to me to be really critical. You know, we're modelling as a country the progressive commitments, the policies, the implementation that recognises the drive towards achieving and securing that right to food, as you're talking about, and really bringing together our policies in a sense of coherence so that they're working together, our policies at home, as Jamie's highlighted, and our policies as we're working in international development. I champion here the role of, I suppose, of Scottish Government in encouraging others, you know, in not only modelling what's happening, but playing a leadership role with the private sector, with the third sector, with other governments to facilitate the kind of collective action that's needed to secure the rights in the way that you're drilling down and asking.
Thank you for his answers. My final question is around the right to development, which is an important aspect of climate justice. Could you help define that for the committee and perhaps explain where you see it fitting into existing conventions of rights, existing domestic legislation, both at home and abroad?
Go to Ms. Sawyers first.
I think I'll let others on the panel and perhaps in the future panel speak to the point about legislation here. I won't speak to areas where I'm not an expert and give you a kind of a false sense of my expertise on those legal points. The right to development, from my point of view as an organisation working alongside partners in Scotland and in our partner countries, really is primarily around the development of a path to low carbon economies in the partner countries we're working, Scotland is working alongside. So, you know, to exemplify that, for example, in the Climate Justice Innovation Fund and the work that we've done, it's where can we embed and support that path towards adoption, adaptation, and the use of and development of low carbon economies in a way that is obviously recognising climate justice and recognising the climate crisis that the partner countries we're working with are at the sharp end of and experiencing. So, not to go into detail, and you'll hear from organisations like Baseflow and others in the later panel, but we have practical examples here of working with partner countries and organisations in partner countries towards that that developed economy, which is a low carbon economy. And I want to emphasise that transition, I suppose, in the context of the climate crisis that we're facing.
Okay. Mr. Livingston?
You know, as Carolyn mentioned in her first answer, rich developed countries developed on the back of unsustainable use of fossil fuels, and we need to recognise that, and therefore we need to move first and fastest in order to reduce our emissions, in order that developing countries can continue to develop. And we need to support them to do that in a way that jumps beyond fossil fuels to more sustainable routes to development. Now, in a Scottish context, of course, the Scottish Government have supported the implementation of the SDGs, which are really important. But I think a really important thing to bear in mind is that the climate crisis is effectively undermining development. Scottish Government funding or from the International Development Fund, for example, is doing some great work in order to support communities in their development objectives. So I remember, for example, watching and finding out about Scottish Government-funded solar panels that were increasing the yields of crops in Malawi. The problem with that was that the solar-powered pumps were pumping water from the nearby river up to increase yields of crops and thereby increasing the community's income. But the drought meant that there simply wasn't enough water. So you were seeing effectively the impact of the climate crisis undermining development. The only other thing I would mention is we really welcome the commitment to the creation of a wellbeing and sustainable development bill in Scotland. And I think that really offers an opportunity to lock in some of the welcome commitments that we're seeing in Scotland to things like policy coherence for development, whereby we don't, in one hand, give international development support and on the other, not meet our climate change targets. And so we, as a rich developed country, have an obligation to develop and deliver our national outcomes as expressed within the national performance framework in ways that don't undermine the opportunities for other countries to develop and create wellbeing too.
Thank you. If I could briefly ask, in both your submissions, in Cora's submission, they talk about the focus on listening to communities. And Mr. Livingston, your own submission, it's about a human-centred approach. And I just wondered if you could say a little bit about what that actually means on the ground. So I'll go to Ms. Sawyers first.
So from our point of view, that really is, I suppose, you know the phrase, it ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. And in this case, it is both what you do and the way that you do it. And I'm delighted you've picked up on those points about participation and voice and partnership. I mean, more broadly in our work, and this is true in Scotland as it is in working in our, with alongside the Scottish Government and partner countries, really funding that starts from and embeds the participation of communities in shaping the work that's undertaken and reflects their key priorities. So, you know, certainly, you know, the Climate Challenge Programme in Malawi is framed in that way, and similarly Climate Justice Innovation Fund over its time period as it's grown over since 2017 has very much embedded those principles of partnership. So how that works in practice, what we do is receive proposals and applications. And it's critical, really, that as we're considering those and thinking, is this the right idea to develop and to fund, to understand how those proposals have been developed alongside and led by communities who are impacted and directly impacted by climate change, how their voices and their leadership has been centred in those proposals, and how their power and agency within those proposals is demonstrated. So how it works in practice, looking at criteria that assure that this proposal is sustainable, that has the voices of communities within it, that it understands issues like gender equity, what's the role of women and girls, you know, and is well embedded within its community. A couple of points just to pick up, you know, perhaps specific to Climate Justice Innovation Fund. So it's a fund that works, that supports partnerships between organisations in Scotland and in partner countries. And progressively is tipping the balance of power between those organisations, and that's certainly a point we would want the committee to have to the front of their minds, the potential for funding approaches to intentionally tip that balance of power and place power, participation and the strength of partnership very much in the Global South. And Climate Justice Innovation Fund's part of the way that that's been brought about is to seek locally led partners to, you know, so not just a partner, an organisation based in a partner country, but a locally led partner who is embedded within a community and who represents and involves and hears the voices and champions the voices of people who are living there every day.
Thank you. Mr. Livingston?
I don't want to go over too much of what Carolyn said, but I would really flag, as we speak right now, actually, a communique is being launched under the banner of the Glasgow Climate Dialogues, which was supported by Stop Climate Chaos and the Scottish Government. And actually, in the session that Oxfam hosted in that on how we boost support for low-income countries to adapt to the climate crisis, that point about locally led adaptation came through really importantly. And there was a clear call for the UN FCCC to integrate the locally led adaptation principles into all their systems and processes, because part of the challenge is that we're seeing far too little climate finance that is mobilised, and we're seeing a big gap in the volume of climate finance mobilised. We're seeing far too little of that reaching the least developed countries and small island developing states. But further than that, we're seeing far too little of it reaching local communities. And yet we know that local communities are best placed to understand their context, best placed to mobilise additional resources and delivery capacity. So So we really need to try to get money to those local communities. And to do that, we need to make sure that our application processes are proportionate, that our accounting processes are proportionate, and that we put in place the capacity support to allow and enable local organisations to lead the delivery of climate justice activities internationally.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Ms Boyack, please?
Thank you, Convener. Welcome to the panel, and thanks for the submissions that you've sent us in advance. They've been incredibly useful. I would like to ask about reflecting on the fact that it's 5 years since the Paris Agreement, and we've got a huge opportunity, stroke obligation, at COP26 in Glasgow. I want to start off with Jamie from Oxfam. In your submission, you highlight the fact that the Paris Agreement had three pillars. It had mitigation, mm-hmm. adaptation, and loss and damage. And most of our focus in Scotland so far has been about mitigation and adaptation. But you mentioned the loss and damage issue, and that comes forward very strongly about capacity of Global South low-income countries to put in the investment. And that comment that you make about we were the founders of the Industrial Revolution in Scotland. So what can we do, given that COP26 is in Glasgow, and our role historically to push that third pillar of the Paris Agreement, which we need to redouble? I think the comment from Alex Sharma when he spoke at the Net Zero Committee was we need £100 billion a year over the next 5 years, 2020 to 2025. Our contribution is going to be great. It's going up, it's doubling up to 6 million. Where are we at this, and what more do we need to do if we're going to lead in Scotland?
Okay, I'll start with Mr. Livingston. Just to let the panel know, Mr. Hegarty is back on board and audio only. But I'll bring in Mr. Livingston first.
You're right. Most of the focus in terms of the Paris Agreement delivery is on the mitigation side. And in terms of a climate justice approach, we, of course, need to drive down emissions quickly. But we need to recognise, as the recent IPCC report really reinforced, is that this isn't a distant threat. Communities need to be able to adapt to the climate crisis they're facing now. And currently, rich countries are abjectly failing to fulfil their $100 billion climate finance commitment. And within that promise, 50% is meant to be going towards adaptation support. But currently, we're only at around 25%. Now, our analysis shows that between 2020 and 2025, we're looking at in the region of a $75 billion shortfall in terms of climate finance support. And yet we know even that $100 billion target was insufficient to meet need. Then on top of that, we need to recognise that there are limits how communities can adapt to climate change. We are now seeing irreversible climate damage, and that then brings you into the conversation about loss and damage. Now, we've seen incremental progress globally in terms of discussing loss and damage. We have an international mechanism now in place in order to drive forward progress, but there's no financial mechanism that sits behind that in order to get loss and damage financed to frontline communities. So alongside increasing climate finance for adaptation, making sure critically that is in addition to overseas development assistance and not displacing it, we also need to see COP26 make progress on that discussion around how we secure the additional finance to deal with those irreversible climate impacts. In terms of Scotland, you know, it's really welcome that we have the Scottish Climate Justice Fund. We were concerned that it had been frozen at £3 million a year for 5 years, despite spiralling climate impacts. We really welcome, however, the increase to £6 million. And crucially, that is separate and additional to the International Development Fund. That allows Scotland, as a sub-state actor, to therefore call on other rich countries to increase their financial commitments. On loss and damage specifically and briefly, there was a dialogue as part of the Glasgow Climate Dialogues on loss and damage, and there was a call made by participants from the Global South for the Scottish Government to consider a solidarity fund in order to demonstrate that leadership on loss and damage ahead of COP26. And that's a really interesting proposal. I think it would have to be additional and separate to the adaptation support and to fulfil or to show as much leadership as possible, we need to demonstrate that we can identify innovative new sources of finance for climate finance and loss and damage. And we need to be driven by the data that shows clearly that emissions are being driven by the richest in society. We need to curb emissions of the richest in society. One way of doing that would be around changing incentives, but we also need to raise new finance by progressive taxation on high emitters, high incomes and wealth.
Thanks. Can I move to Accora Foundation? You're in a position, Carolyn, to access a raft of different donations from big organisations. Is there an appetite for addressing that loss and damage agenda from big financiers and people giving support to charities and foundations like yourself to really make that difference in the next 5 years?
I would hope so, and I think that's an area that certainly merits exploration. Obviously, our experience is more primarily around funds that have been around adaptation. So, I mean, just to echo some of what Jamie's gone through, it's clear that our current action, certainly through Climate Justice Innovation Fund, is more in the space of adaptation, and our actions here in Scotland are primarily more in the space of mitigation. Exploring the potential for raising funds more broadly around loss, again, the Scottish Government can potentially play a leadership role here in bringing together and building funds along with others. It's an area where there are, as you're well aware, there are many government players, there are many large global philanthropists and foundations active in the field more generally. A number of kind of great, is a really well-connected funding community in Scotland of foundations and trusts. I have to say the orientation of most foundations and trusts and givers in Scotland is more primarily towards work in Scotland, and you know, and that's been, I'm sure not surprised you to say that. So part of what's powerful, exciting and interesting about these kinds of sessions and actually, you know, the visibility of COP26 in Glasgow is the way that it brings to the top of the agenda this potential for collective action. You know, so you know that case can increasingly be made, and would expect it to be made. You know, certainly as we drive towards COP26.
Thanks. And Chris, do you have a comment? I can't see if your hand's up or anything, but do you have a comment on the issue?
Sorry. Thank you, Sarah. Sorry, apologies to everybody. My broadband keeps saying it's unstable, so I'm losing connectivity. I do apologise. Really just to try and build on what Jamie said, I think, and Carolyn, but in my experience, the way in which Scotland has the biggest impact on these kinds of issues is by setting helpful precedents. And I wondered about loss and damage, whether there might be a parallel in terms of, I mean, the issue of climate justice maybe 10, 11 years ago was something that really northern governments were very unwilling to even talk about. And the way in which Scotland, the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government started talking about the issue of climate justice was really quite transformational, quite revolutionary in terms of you know, being the first sort of northern country in the world to set up a fund called the Climate Justice Fund. But even just talking in terms of the word climate, the words climate justice, the feedback I had from partners and colleagues in places like Africa at the time was kind of more effusive, if you like, than I expected. Simply having a rich northern government using the term climate justice was significant and very helpful in international terms, was seen as an important breakthrough. And I wonder if there might be scope to do for something similar in terms of loss and damage, because loss and damage is an issue that northern governments, for essentially financial reasons, are reluctant to even talk about. So perhaps that might be a means by which Scotland, Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament can, you know, develop another one of these helpful precedents that can sort of puncture through some of the narrative and linguistic barriers to get this on the agenda, as Jamie has said.
Thanks.
Thank you. Can we move to questions from Mr. Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks. Morning to you all. I just wanted to pick up actually on some of the thoughts around the Human Rights Bill and you know, Jamie's comments there about the Wellbeing Sustainable Development Bill as well. How do we ensure that climate justice is effectively delivered in Scotland? Who does the governance on that? I mean, there's a reference to climate justice, I think, in the Climate Change Act. But I'm thinking about, you know, how do we enshrine it further into legislation, and who kind of champions it? Is there a need for a commissioner or Future Generations Commissioner or some other body or function that ensures that every public body that has a role to play in this is delivering alongside those important principles? I'd be interested in your thoughts about how do we take this to the next stage, because it's a useful principle that is now there, but how do we embed it further in public policy?
Yeah, go to Mr. Livingston first.
So you're right, it is there on the face of the bill. I'm just looking at it now. It says that we will support those most affected by climate change but who have done the least to cause it and are the least equipped to adapt to its effects. So it's really positive, as Chris was saying, that we've got that not just as a rhetorical commitment but actually a in-law commitment in Scotland. In terms of the proposed human rights framework, I think one of the proposals in there is about introducing a right to a healthy environment for everyone, which is really positive. I think we need to make sure that applies out with Scotland's borders as well as inside Scotland's borders, so that our activities here are not undermining the delivery of a healthy environment for people internationally. Scotland has made a lot of progress in areas like things like the National Performance Framework, which is obviously locked in through the Community Empowerment Act. We've got the Climate Change Act. I think you're right, though, that something that falls below those that drives implementation is still necessary. And that's why I think the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill offers an opportunity for us to explore how we can drive that progress. So, for example, making sure that all public bodies have to conduct impact assessments in relation to their decision making on how those decisions will impact internationally, including things like climate emissions. Obviously, Wales have got their Future Generations Bill, which I think has been a useful mechanism in Wales, but there's still an implementation and accountability gap. It's all very well having commissions and commissioners, but unless their recommendations are acted upon, then the realisation of those aspirations is where concern lies. So, you know, in Scotland, that bill, and I think lots of people will be trying to define what that bill looks like, from our perspective, it has to include the international dimension. How are activities in Scotland having knock-on implications for low-income countries, including through things like excessive emissions?
Go to Mr. Hegarty, then Ms. Sawyers. Thanks.
Thank you. Not a huge amount to add to what Jamie just said. I mean, just to be honest, really, in terms of an assessment of these things, there's, I guess, in my mind, a kind of hierarchy of preferences. I think, in terms of these kinds of bills, it's better to have something on the bill or something in the bill than having nothing. And then the next preference is to have you know, greater teeth embedded in the legislation. But as Jamie said, you know, we had an interesting call with colleagues from Wales recently, in light of Scotland being about to embark on the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill, to try and learn from their legislation from some years ago. And they said that, you know, in some of the aspects they've tried to embed that they thought might give them teeth, haven't given quite as many teeth as they might have hoped. And, you know, there are pluses and minuses of having commissioners. They said that in many ways, just having the wording in the bill was perhaps the thing that they used the most in terms of trying to hold decision makers to account for these things. But like I say, there's probably a hierarchy in terms of things we want to get in. And we also have to balance, if I'm honest with you, we have to balance the, you know, how politically likely we are to try and get some of these things in. So these are the kind of things we're weighing up at the moment with regard to our work on the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill.
Okay. Ms. Sawyers?
Again, echo comments that Jamie and Chris have made. I mean, it seems to me that one of the most important messages that we are trying to get across here is the potential power of joining things up, which is inherent in your question. So, you know, there's a lot of good legislation in Scotland, a lot of good strong narrative and commitment. So the potential here is to join that up and make it coherent, integrated and more than some of its parts. Again, thinking about the point about, you know, great narrative and great legislation, what we're really thinking about then is how do you make that happen on the ground and make implementation and the realisation of rights as strong as the statement of them. For me, you know, it's about that matrix of getting all the levers working at the same time. My perspective obviously is very strongly from as a funder of organisations in the third sector, but it seems to me in order to ensure the realisation of rights as well as strong legislation and narrative and commitment, you know, we clearly need capable organisations and well-funded organisations in the third sector who are able to strongly advocate, you know, who are able to hold to account. We need vibrant democracy and people, you know, connected to that, you know, having their voices heard. We need political will. And certainly, I think we need an underpinning effort to ensure that the public dialogue is there as well. So I suppose I'm just trying to add to those points about getting the legislation right and maybe getting the mechanisms right, just to see a rounded picture where you also need, you know, vibrant democracy, strong third sector organisations, support for advocacy, and engagement with the media and the public, you know, to kind of get that underpinning will and desire to progress.
Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to explore two aspects of Scotland's role on the world stage, and I'll start with Jamie Livingstone, if that's okay. So the first part is how do we get more bang for our buck for the investments which Scotland makes in tackling climate justice, and would a thematic approach help to achieve this? You know, so for example, we're potentially facing water wars between competing states over riparian basins, watercourses and aquifers, household level water scarcity. Would, you know, focusing on a particular theme, equally you could focus on human trafficking, access to education, labour standards or renewables or agriculture. So there's obviously a whole variety of themes there, but just would that be something that's worthwhile exploring? And the second part is, Jamie, in your submission you said that the Scottish Government should demonstrate its commitment to climate justice by making clear its opposition to approval of new oil and gas licences. So my question, the second question is, what impact, if any, has the Scottish Government's failure to meet emissions targets over the last 3 years having within this sphere? Over to you.
Two fairly chunky questions, which I'll try to address in turn. In terms of bang for buck, currently there's an evaluation of the Climate Justice Fund going on. There's actually a meeting about that this afternoon to start setting out some of the findings of that, which I'll be joining, and Carolyn's perhaps a better place to talk on that. In terms of the focus, obviously the Scottish Government's International Development Programme is geographically focused on the partner countries, Malawi, Rwanda and Zambia. For exactly that purpose, to try to deepen the partnerships and deepen the bang for buck by having predictable and stable funding. And I think there's general support for that approach. There has also been generally a focus on water and renewables within much of what the Scottish Government has been doing. And, you know, there are two parts to the support that low-income countries need. One is finance, of course, and the other is technology. And therefore, I think it is welcome that there are commitments to set up new global platforms to share learning between Scotland and some of our partner countries on things like renewables and the like as well. So I think all of that, marrying together the technology transfer with the financial support, comes together to increase Scotland's bang for our buck. On Campbell, specifically. We obviously all agree that we need to have a just transition, but the transition needs to start. And the International Energy Agency, the chair of the UKCC at UK level, have both expressed concern that we shouldn't be giving approval for new oil and gas extraction because it's simply not compatible with our climate aspirations. So in that regard, we very much welcome the fact that the Scottish Government has urged the Prime Minister to review existing licences, and we think the next step for that is that the First Minister of the Scottish Government should make clear its own opposition to the Campbell project. You obviously referenced missed targets. Now, Scotland has what we would describe as a relatively strong climate action record. We have, as we've discussed, really strong legal targets, which is great. We've made progress. We've reduced emissions since 1990 by in excess of, I think, 51% or so. The challenge being, though, is that we're falling short of our legal targets. So in 2019, while emissions fell year on year, we still missed our legal target. And that was the third missed target in a row. Now, from our perspective, that places Scotland's climate justice credentials in a degree of jeopardy. The Cabinet Secretary has committed to bringing forward a catch-up plan. And we think that's critical because distant 2045 net zero targets will count for very little unless we get on track to deliver our 2030 emission targets. We need collectively to remain within 1.5 degrees. The UN has been clear on that. The IPCC has been clear on that. So we don't think we can afford to miss any more of our legal targets because it does begin to undermine our championing role, which we want to go into COP26 and beyond, and we want Scottish Government, the First Minister, to be able to go into platforms like the Under 2 Coalition or through the Wellbeing Economy Governments Initiative and really have a credible climate justice example to show that we need to get on track, and that means faster emission reductions now in order to ensure we meet that 2030 target.
Mr. Hegarty?
Thank you. I mean, I was keen to build on Jamie's points and try and answer both questions to the best I can. I think in terms of the question about how do we increase the bang for buck, I mean, I guess I make a distinction in terms of the various strands of work done in Scotland on climate justice. In terms of emissions, then, you know, Scotland is, Holyrood is responsible for emissions cuts in the same way as many other countries are. I think in terms of things like climate finance, then, you know, it's not a devolved area. So it's something in which we end up, innovating and doing some things around the edges. And so if we're talking about how to make the most of that sort of relatively small scale contribution, then, I mean, Christian Aid is very unabashed about saying that poverty is political. And sometimes you can get a much bigger bang for buck if you work on some of the underlying structural issues, essentially on advocacy issues. So, for example, I noticed that the Scottish Government had funded searching for the name, we do, I think it's called Women's Delegates Funds and Training Women, Training Support for Women's Delegates and from Least Developed Countries and COP. So it could be that focusing on one or two key advocacy issues in which Scotland perhaps has a good story to tell and has a particular advantage in supporting could, and perhaps not to the exclusion of the programmatic work that's done, but certainly as an additional important feature, then ultimately you can have much bigger effect through changing things at a structural level than by programmatic on the ground. And in terms of failure to meet targets, yeah, I mean, I think that is, it really doesn't help. It undermines the credibility of the work that's gone on, and it encourages a degree of cynicism, I suppose. I mean, as Jamie has said, though, I mean, ultimately the legislation is strong, the track record is relatively strong in international terms. I think Scotland's cut its emissions by 51% or so since 1990. If you look at some big international comparators, the USA has increased slightly since 1990. Canada has gone up 21% since 1990. So Scotland has a relatively strong story to tell. And I think in terms of emissions, what I would love Scotland to be able to do is to, first of all, cut its emissions far and fast, but also to be able to, if I can put it this way, sell or share that positive story with other parts of the world. And I think that is something that we shouldn't overlook, because there is still that strong positive story to tell, but I do agree that the missing of targets doesn't help in our ability to do that.
Ms. Sawyers?
Thank you. And looking back to the question, and I suppose the first thing that came into my mind was to reflect to you that our bang for the buck at the moment is quite strong, and we'd want to make sure that the committee heard that message. You know, we've been managing 15 grants in the Climate Justice Innovation Fund, you know, making real difference for over 30,000 people in our partner countries. So, you know, what we're funding there, you know, strongly around renewable energy, strongly around innovative farming techniques, there's sort of real benefits to what is, you know, £1.5 million are relatively, you know, in relative terms, a small amount of money. So obviously, you know, there's always potential to increase that bang for the buck, and understand the reason behind the question. But, you know, there's a strong record right now to build on, is the point I want to make sure that you hear. You know, how can you strengthen that? I mean, what we've heard in terms of from our grant holders, from organisations and partner countries, is a strong desire to really strengthen the learning and exchange. And I think that links to the question you're asking. So, you know, what we're doing in Climate Justice Innovation Fund is trialling, testing, developing new technologies. These clearly have potential for benefit, not just immediately for communities we're working alongside, but potentially for wider adaptation and trialling. And the way to really kind of maximise that and get bang for the buck is to intentionally support learning and exchange, in South-South conversations, you know, between partner countries, between communities in partner countries, and with partners in Scotland. And there's a really strong appetite to do that. And if we're thinking about, you know, how do we form and frame, you know, climate justice funding in the future, our advice would be to strongly embed that potential for learning and exchange in order to make the most of the potential technological developments, the adaptations, the reach that spend can have. And the impact of the grants, you know, is really strong. You know, these grants are making a real difference to people's lives. We've got, renewable energy happening, we've got access to electricity, we've got clean water, improved farming approaches. So, you know, this is the kind of work that will make a difference. But, you know, we have to intentionally embed that kind of learning exchange. It will happen to an extent, but to intentionally invest in it and ensure that it's happening as a core part of Scotland's climate justice funding, I think would strengthen and would achieve the stronger bang for the buck that you're looking for.
I think Mr. Livingstone wants back in briefly, and then I'll come back to Mr. Golden. Thanks.
The very brief point to build on Chris's point is to say that international championing role is really important, and that's why we very much welcome the release recently of the indicative nationally determined contribution by the Scottish Government. To be clear, that was an entirely voluntary step. But the fact of putting Scotland's climate action targets and progress into the language that is familiar to parties to the Paris Agreement, I think, is important. And it's particularly important because at the moment, if you the UN is saying that if you add up the combined NDC commitments globally, we're actually on track for emissions to rise by 16% by 2030. So that championing role, that influencing role, is absolutely critical, because Scotland can deliver our targets, but unless we get faster progress internationally, then of course those two things need to go hand in hand.
Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. Just a brief supplementary to Carolyn Sawyers, if I may. You mentioned the substantive positive change of the Scottish Government's Climate Justice Innovation Fund. I wonder if you could just outline what metrics are used to assess that.
Absolutely. So we operate a full and engaged funding programme where partner organisations, both in Scotland and in our partner countries, are tracking a whole range of metrics that are appropriate to the work that they're doing. So, primarily, and the one that's always easiest to talk about, is how many people are experiencing positive change, you know, so who are projects reaching, how many people are they reaching? That's obvious, and that's the easiest one to kind of sum up across a whole range of projects that are obviously doing different work. We're operating a fully engaged monitoring and evaluation process with each partner, and gathering regular information in terms of the achievement, the outcomes that they've set for the projects, and pulling those together to understand the overall impact of the projects and the programme. As Jamie mentioned, there's coincidentally, in terms of timing, brilliant timing, although it might be better if the meetings were the other way around, but there's a publication of the evaluation of the Climate Justice Fund as a whole that's this afternoon, so certainly, you know, we'll be, I'm sure, sharing further information about how the fund has worked as a whole. But from our point of view, and certainly I'd be happy to follow up with committee members on any more detail that would be helpful, we have full monitoring and evaluation reports coming through from each project, 6 monthly reports that are not just about finance, but are about the difference that the projects are making on the ground. And critically, I suppose, the learning that's coming through from that, you know, so what we're learning about the technology and its use in situ on the ground, what we're learning about the different ways to engage people and organisations in the work. So, you know, the whole framework, really, that we'd be delighted to share more information on.
Thank you. That would be great. Thank you, convener. Thank you, panel.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Thank you very much, convener. My first question is really about the voice that people in the developing world have in all of this. You've both mentioned this and referred to it. But I'm keen to know what can be done to bring that powerful voice to the fore, specifically at COP26, and how you feel it's likely to be heard.
Okay, go to Mr. Hegarty first, please.
Thank you. It's been a long-term challenge. I would say that, I'm trying to calibrate this in different contexts. I think in a Scottish context, those voices have been heard. I think the whole issue of climate justice was actually, just thinking back to the 2009 Climate Change Act, I remember the then Cabinet Secretary with responsibility, John Swinney, saying that he was inspired at the end of the whole thing, the whole process, he'd been inspired by the whole concept of climate justice and the voices he'd heard from the Global South. So it's something that we in Scotland have been doing for a long time, with some success. I think the Scottish Government and Scottish politicians of all political colours have been really notably engaged with people from the Global South throughout the last 10 or so years that I've been working on these kinds of issues at COPs, for example. I think the challenge is how to make that more the case, more of the norm. And I think, again, I'm trying to calibrate this in terms of practical things that Scotland or people in Scotland can do. I think civil society in Scotland has put enormous amount of effort into planning for this COP in terms of how civil society can support and amplify the voices from the Global South. So the Stop Climate Chaos Scotland Coalition, through a whole range of processes. I mean, I think Jamie's already talked about the dialogues, through supporting people to visit and stay in Glasgow and have plenty of opportunities to speak. The Scottish Government and Parliament and Government has I mentioned already, supporting training and development for spokespeople from female spokespeople from the least developed countries. That's the kind of thing that we can and should do more of. And I'm speaking from a Christian Aid perspective. You know, we are working to make sure that our spokespeople at COP26 are as diverse as possible and from the Global South where possible. So there's a range of things we can do. I think, again, I come up against the limits to some extent of what we can do in a Scottish context, but there's some of the things that I think we can think about in terms of making sure those voices come to the fore.
Okay. Ms. Sawyers?
Yeah, I'm just reflecting on what Chris has said there, and a lovely phrase about amplifying voices from the Global South, and it was just kind of exactly what was in my mind as well. I mean, from my point of view, not just at COP26, although obviously I understand the reason for the focus of your question, but it seems to me that amplifying voices from the Global South within the way that we think about climate justice funding and indeed wider international development funding is absolutely vital, and that line should be drawn from COP26 onwards. We will clearly go into a new phase of climate justice and international funding as well. As you know, the Scottish Government's taken a wider look at its international development funding not so long ago, and very clearly signalled a shift to amplifying and strengthening the voice of countries from the Global South within that process, and not just their voices, but their actual power as well. And I suppose that, you know, from my point of view, we use the term voice in CORA a lot, but it's not just amplifying voices, but it's listening to them. It's those voices making a difference in real decisions. And this is, from a grant-making point of view, is a much wider trend, actually, of participatory grant-making, which, you know, we would absolutely endorse and follow through, not just in climate justice funding, but in any funding. So, you know, really that kind of wider role, I suppose, for a strong voice from the Global South, not just at COP26, but in funding. And for us, really, it's about rebalancing and recalibrating that sense of power. And relationships is the word that's in my mind here, that relationships and trust are a two-way street. And I think, again, we need to intentionally build relationships which are respectful, transparent, accountable, and which have a real sense of parity of power and partnership. And that's the approach that will, in the long term, make Scotland's role in terms of climate justice funding, I think, as strong as it can be.
Mr. Livingstone. Is Mr. Livingstone still with us?
Yeah, I think it would be remiss not to say that the concerns around participation in relation to COP26 in Glasgow are a level up from the pre-existing concerns that have long been held about Global South voices being heard and listened to, as Carolyn said. Obviously, there's a great focus on the challenges of Global South attendees coming to Glasgow. It would be remiss not to point to the underlying vaccine inequality that is fueling some of that, with a context as we speak of only around 2% of adults in low-income countries actually fully vaccinated right now, which is a critical issue that all rich developed countries need to act upon urgently. But there's also, in general, a mismatch between what is going on outside of COPs and inside of COPs. I was fortunate that I went to the COP in Madrid, and there was a real sense of frustration that the upsurge in Global South voice in the chambers or the corridors outside the formal negotiations really weren't filtering through to the urgency that was coming through within the chamber. And during the Glasgow climate dialogues, which were specifically designed to try to ensure that Scotland plays a role using its soft power at COP26 to amplify the voices of the Global South, you know, the Ambassador of Belize was talking about COP26 really being a point of reckoning in terms of the role played by rich developed countries. Only other point I would make is, alongside the funding for that the Scottish Government is giving to support women to participate throughout the UNFCCC processes, it's also really positive that they've funded the Conference of Youth coming up, given the intergenerational concerns and the fact that really young people are pulling the rest of society along towards the more urgent action that really delivery of the Paris Agreement requires.
Thank you. And building on that point that you've just made there, Jamie Livingstone, about the nature or the shape of COP26, we often talk about COP26 in quite abstract terms without much of an idea of what the agenda and the format looks like and who's allowed in to what. So I just wondered if you could say a bit, both of you, about how your organisations or the organisations you're affiliated to actually engage with COP26 and what bits of it, given the concern that we've heard expressed, to make sure that the voices of the Global South are heard.
Mr. Livingstone?
So organisationally, Oxfam internationally attends COP, and we do that in order to hold bilateral meetings on the fringes of the formal negotiations. And a big part of what we're trying to do through that is to to be a conduit to amplify the voices of the Global South. So, for example, at COP26, we'll be bringing a smallholder Ugandan farmer to COP26 in Glasgow and trying to create platforms for her voice to be heard. Because in order to rebalance power dynamics and give opportunities for the Global South, sometimes that requires Global North participants to step aside, use their power to join the dots, and then allow Global South voices to be heard strongly. I do think, you know, people talk about COP26. Within COP26, it's a huge operation with multiple streams going on throughout the 2 weeks. So you have to be quite targeted in terms of saying what are the work streams that we're going to be trying to influence. So for Oxfam, really, the focus will be on climate finance, getting rich developed countries to fulfil that $100 billion promise, and to go further and recognise that really that is hugely insufficient, and that we need a new global target for post-2025 that really reflects the scale of the adaptation needs that are required.
Mr. Hegarty?
Thank you. I mean, not a huge amount to add to what Jamie said. I guess the other dimension I would bring in is that Christian Aid is an organisation with substantial presence in the UK, based in the UK, and with the COP presidency, you know, being with the UK at the moment, then I guess another dimension has been substantial work with and to towards directed at the UK government in terms of its particular role in this particular COP in terms of shaping the agenda. So, I mean, in some ways, we've tried to act as something of a conduit between the issues raised and prioritised by the communities with which we work in Africa, Asia and Latin America, and raising that voice or those voices with the UK government and in its role as with the COP presidency. So things like women's participation, climate finance, loss and damage, and just the sheer urgency of cuts in emissions. So, like I say, in addition to the things that Jamie's talked about, we operate in a similar way to Oxfam in many respects there, but just to add that other dimension. And I guess in the Scottish context too, if I'm honest, it's been quite difficult to work out the role of the Scottish Government within this COP. And to the extent that we can, we've tried to work with the Scottish Government to help it to raise its voice where appropriate within this COP as well.
Ms. Sawyers.
To add, as the grant managers for Climate Justice Innovation Funds, our main engagement today has been making sure that there's some really, you know, strong and powerful case studies available that the Scottish Government will be using as part of COP26. So organisations such as those you'll hear from later, make sure their stories and the impact of their work is being heard as part of the process. And secondly, just to mention that from a more local point of view, actually, independent funders in Scotland have done a little bit of coordination to think through how best we can make sure there's some support available to Scottish organisations working on environmental climate justice here locally in Scotland. So just make sure we're a wee bit joined up, and that's probably slightly more about organisations who'll be on the outside of some of the formal proceedings and of COP26, but making sure that as funders we're working together and a wee bit intelligently to identify some of the great work that's happening in Scotland that we hope would have a voice. And then just lastly, slightly more broadly, to say that COP26 itself is obviously provides a framework for independent funders, trusts and foundations to be reflecting on their own practice and what's happening. And I would expect there is some engagement of international funders within the COP26 framework through a global organisation. But more broadly, it's actually prompting a strong discussion about what's happening around funding for the third sector in Scotland around environmental issues, so around climate justice locally in Scotland. So not an area where there's significant independent funding at the moment in Scotland. So some knock-on impacts of COP26 in Glasgow for funding more broadly.
Thank you. I heard it diplomatically put there that it was unclear what role the Scottish Government might have. I suppose that's a question that would have to be addressed to the UK host of the conference. But on another theme, I was interested to know, about the Scottish Government itself. I mean, what lessons the Scottish Government can learn from not just COP, but some of the issues that you're raising as organisations about climate justice in terms of how to mainstream the things that we're doing in international development as a government and into all parts of government in Scotland.
So, Ms. Sawyers?
That's a big question, and we'll try and chunk it up in my head to answer it in a succinct way. I mean there are two or three clear points from the management of climate justice funds, which, you know, we hope are I'm happy to we included in our written submission and happy to just summarise here. Also, I think, be echoed in the evaluation of the climate justice fund that's being discussed later today. You know, so there are clear points that we would want the Scottish Government to take on board about, as we've talked about before, the importance of learning and exchange within funding, the importance of locally led partners, the importance of participation voice and really making that central to the processes and the way that funding is distributed and shared. Thinking about some of the sort of broader lessons for Scottish Government work, I mean, it's clearly an area where there's an example here to be made of the potential for joining up, what we're doing around international development and the learning with broader policies that are, again, you know, progressive within Scotland around community-led action, community empowerment, support for diversity, equity and inclusion. So there's a whole range of progressive work that's happening in Scotland that's very much informed by and speaks to our international work that should be reinforced. Touched there just briefly in my previous answer on what we're actually doing in Scotland, and that from a funding point of view is an area where I believe there's room to strengthen. But, you know, pick up some of the things that Connor Foundation, just since I've got the chance, is doing. We're working alongside some partners supporting the development of Scotland's first young people's forests. So I'm just, and that's a development led by young people. So there is work now in train that is helpfully and mutually reinforced by our work in our partner countries. So, you know, I think we need to kind of focus on the potential for that.
Mr. Hegarty.
Thank you. I guess the scale of what is required in climate change is such that it needs to be joined up. Sorry, forgive me, I'm getting an echo here. I'll carry on now. I think it's gone. Yeah, the scale of what is required on climate change is such that it needs to be a cross-departmental thing. That's perhaps the biggest lesson. But to be fair, I think the Scottish Government and Parliament recognised that some time ago. And I think several years ago set up a cabinet subcommittee on climate change to try and pull it together in a cross-governmental way. So really just the need to continue to do it on that basis. And as Caroline said, the need to join up, I think, so something we've been working with the Scottish Government on for some time is the need to make to have policy coherence for development so that you're not sort of making things better on the one hand and perhaps damaging in the other respect in other respects, and really to weave that into just to continue with that strand of work and to weave that together with the work on climate change. Climate change, the impact that the Scottish Parliament and Government can have through climate change, I would argue, is one of the biggest single ways in which we can have an impact on international development. So really just to try and weave those two things together.
Thank you. Mr. Livingston. Is Mr. Livingston there?
Yes, I am. I don't want to take us in a totally different direction. Are you hearing me okay? Or
yes, we are. Yeah, thanks.
Fine. It's to say that one of the key lessons, I think, has to be, whilst we've talked today a lot about climate justice internationally, we need to be delivering climate justice within Scotland too. And that means trying to find opportunities to drive down our emissions in Scotland in ways that also support social justice in Scotland. You know, we have far too many people in Scotland who face fuel poverty. We need to find ways that target our emission reductions at the high emitters. And that tends to be those with high incomes and wealth, curbing excessive emissions from car travel through investment in public transport that we know will disproportionately benefit those in poverty, curbing excessive emissions from flights, rekindling the work on the circular economy. It's still there in the background, but seems to have been pushed further into the Parliament. I think we need to pick that up. And the only other thing I would mention is around really acting upon the now increasingly widespread calls for greater conditionality in access to public money, so that we require private sector companies who are accessing Scottish Government funding to actually support the transition that we need. The Advisory Group on Economic Recovery called for that, the previous lead Climate Change Committee in the last Parliament called for that, and we really need to see that coming through in things like Fair Work First and the like, so that we actually harness the collective weight of Scotland and recognise government can't do it alone. We need the private sector's weight behind it as well.
Thank you. Could I invite Ms Minto to ask her question?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. It's been a very, very informative evidence session. I'd like to focus on young people, if possible. In all your submissions, you talked about harnessing the transformative power of education for climate stewardship. So I'm interested to know what you've talked about the Young People's Forest, and we talked about Young COP as well, how your organisations are working with young people in Scotland and perhaps connecting them with young people in the Global South and allowing the Global South's young voice to connect with our young voice as well. Thank you.
Go to Mr Hegarty.
Thanks. I'm going to pick up on two strands of that, if I may. First is around the whole notion of education and climate change. And I think Scotland has something of a wide open goal, or well, we as civil society and climate campaigners in Scotland have a wide open goal via the Curriculum for Excellence and the focus on global citizenship. And it's something that, you know, not many countries do have in terms of embedding issues of sustainability and climate change in the education system, in the heart of the curriculum. So it's something that we do. We've already developed several resources focusing on the issue of climate change and really trying to bring the whole issue of climate justice to light for our young people via working with schools. So we have, if I can plug some of our resources, you can find them on our website for schools and for young people on the issue of climate justice in the run-up to COP. And I guess in terms of trying to how do we bring young voices to the, you know, COP26, at the moment we're focusing on one of our major mobilisations is with an organisation called YCCN, and they are undertaking a relay all the way from the G7 down in Cornwall, that's culminating, coming to COP in Glasgow. They're walking, or it's a relay, a walking relay throughout much of the UK. It's arriving in Scotland, I think, on the 15th of October. And that's one of our major mobilisations, really to try and get young people involved from throughout Scotland on the route of the march. It's coming to Berwick upon Tweed, or the border just north of Berwick, on I think the 15th of October, and then walking through East Lothian, Edinburgh to Glasgow. So that's one of the major focuses we have in terms of getting young people involved in COP and inspiring them this year.
Thank you. Ms Sawyers?
I suppose the two or three quick points from me, the first I wanted to mention was that young people have been inspiring us as an organisation to do things. So hopefully it makes complete sense given the question that you've asked. But I actually think that, you know, we've found young people to be well ahead of us in this, that their leadership is leadership that we are following as an organisation, that they've inspired us, our organisation, our staff team and our partners to be taking more action for ourselves as an organisation, looking at our carbon footprint, etc., and also to think about the role that funders, foundations and trusts play in Scotland and internationally around the climate crisis. So, you know, I just want to acknowledge young people's leadership in that, and if we can be alongside them and supporting their voice and their journey, then we're happy to do so. Two points to mention on that. I mean, Cora Foundation's involved in a wider movement which is called I Will, which is supporting young people's social action. I just want to put that on your radar to say, not surprisingly, how strongly that work, which happens in local communities across Scotland, in fact across the UK, how strongly that work is informed by young people's social action around climate and the climate crisis. So it's a clear focus of their work, and us as funders and others involved in that advisory group are supporting that. I mentioned a minute ago the Young People's Forest in Scotland, which is in development, a highly engaged young people's panel who are thinking about how will they plant it, how will they design it, how will they own it, how will they find a site. A really exciting example, and I'd so love for them to be at a point when in a few weeks' time COP26 happens, for them to be able to tell the story of where they've got to, and perhaps even use it as a fundraising opportunity to get that forest planted in the future. Just looping back to Climate Justice Innovation Fund, and just to kind of mention very briefly that, of course, a number of the projects that have been funded do have a very strong youth element to them, so that the potential is there certainly to connect up young people who are involved in those projects in partner countries internationally, and certainly with communities and young people in Scotland.
Mr. Livingston?
Just briefly, one of the demands that are being made by young people is for teaching on climate issues to be core within the education system. Now, it is there. It's one of the four key pillars, I believe, within the Curriculum for Excellence. We've got the entitlement to learning for sustainability as well. But, of course, teachers need to be supported to deliver upon that entitlement. It's been really positive in recent years that the Scottish Government has funded the network of development education centres across Scotland to provide that kind of DPD support to teachers, produce resources that they can use within the classroom. We've funded the West of Scotland Development Education Centre to produce a specific teaching resource on COP26, which I would really commend to the committee. And it's really important, though, and it loops back to something that Carolyn was saying, was these centres are embedded within local communities. Their funding isn't particularly secure, and I would really commend their work and urge the Scottish Government to continue to invest in it so that teachers have the support they need in order to realise the welcome legislative commitments to giving young people the skills to critically interrogate the world around them, not to tell them what to think, but to give them the tools through which they can make up their own minds and raise their own voice.
Can I ask, if we try to be brief, we're run right up against time for this morning's panel, but Ms. Minter, do you want to come back in?
It's not so much a question, it's more a comment. I was really pleased to see Caroline's face light up when she talked about the Young People's Forest. I have to admit a connection in that I'm the champion for Celtic rainforests. So I would like you, if possible, to put that on your list as possible suggestions for the woodland.
Thank you. I don't think I'll go back to the panel then, but I want to thank everyone this morning for their attendance and also for your submissions, which were really helpful to the committee for today's session. And I'm going to suspend briefly while we change the panel over. Thank you. bit pushed for time, so I will. Thank you. So, welcome back to agenda item 4 on climate justice, and can I introduce our second panel for this morning. We have Professor Tassim Jaffrey, Director, Caledonian University Centre for Climate Justice. Muti Shema, Director of Baseflow Limited, and Dr. Geraldine Hill, Advocacy Manager for Scottish Catholic International Aid Fund, SCIAF. We are tight for time this morning, so if I could ask for contributions and questions to be succinct, that would be really helpful. I want to have an introductory question with each of you in turn. And could I start by asking Professor Jaffrey if she could just summarise on the summit on climate justice, which she hosted last week, to give us a flavour of the discussion and outcomes and how you see that feeding into COP26.
Thank you. Very, very good morning. And yes, it was a fantastic conversation. We were overwhelmed and overdelighted with the content and the quality and the contributions of the Second World Forum on climate justice. And what really struck out to me is the pace of how fast the conversation is moving on climate justice. We were connected live from Vanuatu right through to Inuit communities in Canada. That was as far-reaching as it was. We had new insights, new research, approaches and developments that have been taking place right across the globe. And I think the things that really struck out from this World Forum is the need not just to work as individuals, but how connected this conversation needs to be. It needs to be connected across disciplines and across landscapes, across social actors. And the direction of travel for climate justice has moved on quite considerably over the last 5 to 6 years since I started working on this. And we're now in the realms of looking at not just the technology solutions, which relate to not just the mitigation but adaptation approaches to tackling the impacts of climate change, but how the conversation has really moved towards the need and the urgency to look at social and human, not just values, but approaches to supporting building resilience and helping communities cope with the impacts of climate change. So it was, in terms of how it relates to COP26, this World Forum is taking that insight and shaping those conversations and the platforms that the centre is involved in across the full 2 weeks of the COP26 programme, whether it's in the blue zone or it's the green zone or it's out of those zones and on campus. And we're influencing the kind of like the agenda that's out there, not just by what climate justice is, but how do we do it? What's the methodology? What's the approach? And how do we take it forward and implement it to see structural change further down the line? And from a practical point of view, I think this is a really, really important point in time that we move and shift the conversation from just a conceptual idea and the niceties behind it into something that's tangible, meaningful, and measurable. That's where the direction of travel is going. And I just want to say we were honoured to have the DG of the WHO, Mary Robinson, Nigel Topping, and everyone across this whole platform, including Indigenous communities, talking about the need to highlight and bring to the fore the justice issues of climate change.
Thank you. If I could turn to Mr. Shema. Thank you very much for joining us from Malawi this morning. I wonder if you could say just a little bit about your work and your relationship with the Scotland-Malawi partnership. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you very much and thank you for welcoming me. First off, I hope the assumption is not that I speak for all Malawians. I am just one voice of many. And I think my perspective in terms of the work that I have done with Scotland in the relationship between Malawi and Scotland has mostly been in the water sector. So I'll speak more broadly about that. My organization has worked very closely with the University of Strathclyde as part of the Climate Justice Water Futures Program for the last 4 going on 5 years. there were several components to the programme, but I think the largest, I'd say the crown jewel of the programme was a national water point mapping exercise that looked at trying to map all water assets in rural Malawi. Now, this was actually quite significant because the last time the Malawi government did such an exercise, they assumed they had 77,000 water assets. When we were completed with our exercise, we were able to find over 100,000 of them. So there was 25% more than what the government assumed was out there. And that was made possible because of the Climate Justice Water Futures Programme in partnership with not just the University of Strathclyde, but several organisations. So my organisation was just one, but there were several organisations working together with the Malawi government. As was mentioned earlier by Mrs. Stoyer from the Cora Foundation, my organisation has also been a beneficiary of the Climate Justice Innovation Fund. One particular grant is very technical, so I'll not spend a lot of time on that, but the one grant that I think links very closely to climate justice, and I think I like the previous speaker who said trying to focus on the justice in climate justice. One of the pieces of work that we've gotten support for is looking at how we can hold non-state actors accountable for failed water assets. The mapping exercise we did proved that there's a lot of assets being installed in rural Malawi with resources from different development partners. But most of those are not installed according to standard, meaning that they break down sooner than they're supposed to because they were not installed properly. And then we put blame on the poor for the failure of those systems, which itself is an injustice. And these are systems that are meant to build community resilience to the impacts of climate change. If they're installed properly, people will have water that they can use during times of drought and other natural disasters. So this is, to be honest with you, I didn't expect to get funding for it because it's very risky, because essentially most of the accountability work looks at holding government accountable. And yes, government must be held accountable. But NGOs and drilling companies, private companies, are not held accountable. And what the work I'm doing in partnership with the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency as my Scottish partner is trying to develop a framework for making that happen, to see how we can hold them accountable. But by raising the community voice to be the ones to hold these stakeholders accountable. And what my organization is doing is providing the data and the space to enable that to happen. So that's how my organization has been benefited from the Scotland-Malawi partnership, and how that is also impacting work here in Malawi in terms of the water sector.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Hill, your submission says that we should be championing the principle of additionality, and you believe that there's potential to be a global leader in this area. I wonder if you could just give us briefly some more context about that.
I'm sorry, you'll need to point me to where it talks about it in the submission because someone else wrote it. Could you point me to the section? I'll elaborate if I can.
I don't have it in front of me at the moment, but do you want to just say a little bit about where you think the priorities are?
Sure. I think that's maybe better. I mean, I think all the discussion earlier was really interesting on, you know, what climate justice means, what the approach means for the Scottish Government. I mean, I think for us, there's two key aspects to that. One is how the Scottish Government approaches through its international development work, support for work on the ground. And the other element is all the policy coherence stuff, which, you know, you talked about in the last session. In terms of the support on the ground, PIAF implemented the Climate Challenge programme in Malawi, which really was, from our point of view, a fantastic success. We did a virtual visit with the minister a couple of weeks ago so that she could get to see in person the approach that was used. It has helped over 40,000 people, the majority of them women and girls in southern Malawi, to improve their access to food, water and energy so that they are better equipped to cope with climate change and with climate disasters. And we think it's really been this fantastic success in terms of female empowerment, increasing household income and also protecting volatile livelihoods from extreme weather events. In the last session, you were talking quite a lot about locally led adaptation. We think this is key. This is really important to build from the bottom up. The way that the CCPM project was implemented was through seven local partners and very much listening to, you know, what was it they were saying that they needed as a starting point. And so, and then secondly, based on the leave no one behind approach, and I think you were touching a little bit on this in the last session. So it very much ensured participants from different vulnerable groups and communities, so disadvantaged women, men, youth, elderly, disabled people, were all included in the consultation, the design and the implementation phases of the programme. And there was a real strong emphasis on gender, employed to ensure meaningful participation through like female-only forums, and then design and implementation and all of that. And as a result, there are now more than 505 women in leadership positions, changing the dynamics of communities and providing really good examples to young girls. Another aspect to it was increasing climate literacy. And this ensured that participants understood their human rights in terms of climate change and encouraged them to speak up about them. It also raised awareness of district government officials on their rights and responsibilities on climate change. And I think this is quite an important part, that when we're trying to support communities, we need to think about supporting the capacity to do their own advocacy. I think it was mentioned earlier as well. So it's important that that element, I think, is maintained within the work, because that's what's going to get the long-term impact. And it's also important that we build up the links between how we're supporting communities on the ground at the local level, what they can do at the local district and national level, but then also how that can feed up to the international climate architecture. And then that brings us to the point about COP and, you know, how we enable those partners on the ground at the local level to... You've already been talking about it earlier. I mean, from SCIAF's point of view, we're also bringing partners. We're bringing partners from Malawi, from Zambia, from Colombia, COP. And one of our top priorities and one of our top objectives is to ensure that those partner voices are heard. And that's why we've also been working very closely with the Scottish Government. We were kind of leading on SCCS's co-hosting of the Glasgow Climate Dialogues, which Jamie mentioned earlier on. I think the launch of the communique was this morning, so it'd be great for the panel to look out for that. It was mentioned earlier, the four key issues that were getting discussed at the dialogues. One of them was loss and damage, which you've been talking about earlier. Global participation, you were talking about that earlier, and all the kind of access to vaccines and all those kind of issues, which have been... which is another hugely important issue, and part of that whole policy coherence question too, and then adaptation. So I think there's the whole side of the approach to what's happening on the ground and how we go about doing that and localised adaptation and all that, and then there's all the policy coherence stuff too, which basically we kind of agree with everything that was being said earlier on by Oxfam and Christian Aid on that.
Thank you. And just for reference, it was section 3 of your submission. And it was about financial additionality, so I probably didn't make that clear in my question, but we can come back to that later. I'm going to move to questions from Mr. Cameron. And I can just remind everyone, we are kind of tight for time, so if we could have succinct answers, that would be really helpful. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Welcome to the panel. I'm just going to pose the same question which I asked the previous panel, which is, to ask about human rights, which is, of course, a central principle of climate justice, and to ask, there is obviously a difficulty in converting theory into practice, and I've greatly enjoyed listening to what you've been just saying about what you're doing on the ground. But in terms of human rights in particular, how do we overcome the challenges of protecting human rights and enforcing them as a matter of practical application when across the world different thresholds and different standards are applied?
Okay, if we go to Professor Jaffrey first.
Yes, sure. Thank you for that question. And I think it is hugely complicated. There's no doubt about it. But I think just getting directly to answering the question, the first one about protecting and enforcing, it's For me, it's about working very closely with different bodies and different frameworks, the UN Security Council, for example, working aligned very closely with the UNHCR, for example. And it's our position and our and what we stand for, our values. And it's that one where we're trying to instill our approach, our thinking, our direction and our vision for all of this, and working very closely with those big frameworks and the big actors that are then going to be able to put in place those practical approaches that can then protect, that can trickle down, I guess, to global and local levels, that to embed some of those values into those approaches. And I think that's that seems to be a missing gap here as well, and I completely agree, because the direction of travel that we're seeing so far with the work that's been done with the Climate Justice Fund, it's more around the technology in some sense. It's about the water access, it's about the solar panels, it's about those sorts of things. And I think what we need to do is see a step change towards building those alliances, building those relationships, and showing how our power, not just our power, but how influential we can be in changing the landscape as we move forward. And I think that's an important contribution that Scotland can make, because it's a hugely hugely complex area to break into.
Can I invite Mr. Shema to answer?
Thank you very much. I will most likely speak directly from the Malawian perspective, because I think the issue that I'm dealing with is concerning the right to water, which, by the way, is not in Malawi's constitution. It is assumed that that the right to water is sort of built into the right to life. And this was something that was a bit of a surprise to me as we were doing some of the work on the Climate Justice Innovation Fund. And the question you're asking is one that I've been reflecting on quite a lot as a practitioner here. Because one of the reasons why it's difficult to enforce human rights is when you have institutions that aren't functioning. And I think for Malawi, that is the fundamental problem that we have. If you take a step back from all the problems Malawi has, Malawi has two problems. An abdication or an inability of institutions to do their job, that's number one. And two, a lack of accountability mechanisms to ensure those institutions do what they're supposed to. And the work that I've been doing, you know, going into communities, talking to chiefs, talking to women, understanding how when we share the data with them and say, this water point that was given to you should not have been given to you. It did. It was not installed properly. They understand that there's been an injustice. Now, the problem is, how do they claim their rights? And as the problem has been going on, one of the things I've discovered, yes, using community development approaches where you bring people together, they talk, they have scorecards and things like that, those kind of community engagements are welcome, but they're not enough. And one of the things that my organization is doing at the moment is really looking at how can we use the legal framework to enforce the right to water. That is something that that my organization is looking at. So trying to work with legal practitioners. I'm not a lawyer, but my organization is working with legal practitioners and institutions like the Malawi Human Rights Commission, which are mandated to ensure the protection of human rights, so that this can also be something that they track, that this is something that they could also ensure is being enforced. And I think the grants like the Climate Justice Innovation Fund or the Climate Justice Fund itself could look at supporting these institutions. Supporting organizations like mine is fine, but like I said, the problem, the fundamental problem, is a failure of institutions to do what they're supposed to. And I think that's where the investment must go. And one of the things I am doing right now, which is outside of the funding from Scotland, is trying to see if we can work with the women who have been impacted by the failed water assets to take the drilling companies or NGOs or the local regulator to task, which means legally taking them to task within the legal frameworks of the country. So I think that's long-winded, but that would be my response. Malawi has the legal frameworks to ensure that. The issue is just making them happen and catalyzing that to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Hill? Dr. Hill, are you with us yet?
Yeah. Can people hear me?
Yes, we can now. Thank you.
Okay. I think what I would say on this is maybe just echoing what Muti said. It's about voluntary versus mandatory approaches. For a number of years, I worked with human rights environmental defenders in Latin America. And there's a real huge increasing problem of environmental defenders being criminalised or for the work that they do. We work in Colombia, and that's one of the countries where environmentalists are most at threat. And so at the UK level at the minute, there's some work which is trying to bring about a new law to hold companies to account when they fail to prevent human rights abuses and environmental harms. And this law is obviously, it's about a mandatory approach, trying to get insurance for undertaking companies to undertake human rights and environmental due diligence. Now, I know this is obviously at a UK level. At the UN level, there's been voluntary approaches for a long time, the voluntary principles on business and human rights, for example. So I suppose my contribution would be, yeah, how do we enshrine this stuff in law? Because often what we see is that voluntary approaches are severely lacking when it comes to implementation.
Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks very much. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to perhaps start with Professor Jaffrey and just ask you about the sort of principles, I guess, that are in the Paris Agreement and the UN framework on climate change around the respective capabilities of states and what that really means in practice. And perhaps could I get your views in relation to the just transition? Does this effectively mean that states that have more capability, more wealth, should be making a just transition faster than others? How is that being interpreted?
Thanks for that question. I mean, there's no doubt about it that the biggest global emitters, the G7, have the biggest responsibility in cutting their carbon emissions. The challenge before us is the how question. It's the methodology in that whole process of transition. And I think that the just aspect is what a lot of organisations and stakeholders are really grappling with. What, not just about what does the just mean, but how do you do it? What is the approach? What's the methodology? And how do we measure change that's come about? And with reference to the just aspect, it is that one about relating to the Sustainable Development Goals. It's about ensuring that no one is left behind in this journey. And for us, the just means ensuring diversity, inclusivity, that representation, and that people have a part, everyone has a part to play in this journey. And at the same time, ring fencing and providing that social protection for those who are maybe going to be at the bottom end or the receiving end of that process of change, which we must all ensure does not happen. We're already seeing this play out in the United States with Joe Biden and, you know, the declarations that are coming out from there. At the same time, it is about ensuring, you know, the diversity in the jobs and skilling and upskilling, and ensuring that that whole process takes place equitably and fairly. But I think that the really significant part of this is, as we go through this process, we need to be really mindful of what it is that we want to achieve as a result of this, and how are we going to measure over the short, medium and the long term the just aspect, so that we can look back and say with confidence that we did achieve not just a transition, but it was fair and it was equitable and it was just. And this is how we're measuring it. So it's complex. It's challenging. But I think this is the difficulty in this journey just now that I sense from across different organisations about how do we do this?
Mm-hmm. I don't know if other panellists want to come in at this point, but
Mr. Shima, do you wish to comment?
Could you repeat your question? I think my line was breaking up, so I didn't catch the last part. Yeah. If you could just repeat your question, thank you.
Yeah, it was primarily, Mr. Shima, about the just transition and about whether countries that have got more capability, effectively more wealth, should be accelerating their just transitions.
Okay. Well, I don't think there's much I could add to that because, again, I'm speaking from the Malawian perspective. But what I could say, if there's one thing I could add, I think as a country, as Scotland, you one of the commitments that you have made is doubling your contribution to Climate Justice Fund, which is something, as many have already said, is laudable. And I think there's a lot of discussion. It's very easy for people in the South, like myself, to say, what should you do more of as northern countries? And of course, for obvious reasons, because of your relatively more contribution to greenhouse gas emissions as compared to the South. But that said, there is still a question of what the South itself has to do. And in this case, I'm speaking specifically about Malawi, because Malawi itself also has to go through a transition. Because as much as you're looking at the sort of the what does justice mean globally? For me, justice, of course, from my sector, I've already mentioned about justice in this case being the poor should not be given assets that fall apart shortly after they've been installed. That's one aspect of justice for me. But I think if we look at it from an environmental perspective, you're seeing, I think there's a lot Malawi needs to do that it's not doing when it comes to sort of protecting and having a better stewardship of its environment. I think it's no news to everyone that the environmental degradation is quite severe in my country. And this is having knock-on effects on the water resources, as well as putting people more at risk of natural disasters. So I guess my point is, as much as people are saying, what should Scotland do? I think what Scotland should do using the soft power and the access and the friendship that Scotland has with Malawi is to also challenge Malawi and say, what are you doing? What can you do about better stewardship of your natural resources? Because we also have a part to play in this. We're not just merely recipients of funding. We are also contributing to the degradation. And I think that also needs to come out clearly. As much as developed nations need to do their part, developing countries like mine also need to do the same. I just wanted to add that. Thank you.
Dr. Hill?
Will I just come in here? Yeah. So basically, I think one of the things that's just come out from the Glasgow Climate Dialogues has been clear that the just transition really needs to be based on the UNFCCC principles of common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities and the right to development, which requires all countries to do their fair share of emissions reductions. And obviously, given everything that we know and given what you've heard in the previous session as well, Scotland has to do, you know, its fair share means Scotland, early industrial country, which is a huge responsibility, both moral and legal duty to act. In terms of kind of what that looks like in terms of climate justice credentials, we put in at the end of our submission a series of things which we think would need to be considered if Scotland is to do its fair share.
Can I just follow up on that? I mean, there are some really quite difficult questions for Scotland to answer in relation to just transition. I mean, one is about transition away from oil and gas. And we recently had the just transition commissioners into the Net Zero Committee in Parliament. And they put a very difficult question to us, which is that as we're transitioning away from oil and gas, we'll still have some residual demand, even if we're keeping to the terms of the Paris Agreement. And the question is really kind of, well, where does that oil and gas come from? And as they put it, there are three options. It could come from countries where it's cheapest, such as the Middle East. It could come from new sources like Ghana, which will have most economic development impact, or it could come from domestic sources. So, I mean, from a climate justice perspective, where do you think our oil and gas, our residual oil and gas demand should be coming from in the future?
Okay, go to Dr. Hill first, since you're on camera already.
And that's a hard one.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really hard one, and I don't have the answer, but I think it's about, you know, We're not, it's not, obviously, you know better than I do. It's not a switch off the tap. We need to get out of oil and gas. Yep. It's clear. But how do we do it? How do we transition through to that? Moving out of oil and gas and building into renewables and all the rest of it. It's a really, really difficult one. I really don't have the answer. I do think Mutti's input was really interesting, because one of the things that we obviously hear from our own partners in the Global South, wait a minute, we haven't developed yet. You know, we still need this oil and gas to develop. We don't have the resources yet in renewables and everything else. So it's how quickly can they build that up so that they're not having to go down the route of over-reliance on oil and gas. But that in the Global South is a big topic of discussion as well, because it's like, we know that we need to move out. We know that we don't want to have the same development path that you had, but how quickly can we do it? And right now, if we've got the reserves, actually, we kind of need to use them. So it's a difficult one.
Could I ask Professor Jaffrey that same question then? Because obviously there is a right to development that's important as well. But I suppose the question is what type of development?
I think, you know, with reference to the residual, where is it going to come from? And you mentioned the cheapest. Is it from Ghana? Is it from domestic sources? And I think what we must be really mindful of doing is not transferring our position, our responsibility and our contribution to greenhouse gas emissions and offsetting it and you know, getting it from countries from other parts of the world. This is our issue, our problem, and it's, you know, we need to work very, very hard to address that challenge. So I think the onus of responsibility lies with us in Scotland, and, you know, it is domestic sources. And I think acknowledging that and recognising that, but also having a very clear vision as to how that's going to filter out. And like, you know, like everyone knows, it's not going to happen overnight. But I think it's really important from a climate justice perspective that we don't continue to place that burden and that onus of responsibility to other nation states. This is something that we need to really work on, hard as it might be. But I think it's our job and our responsibility to do that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know if Mutti's got any perspectives on this,
No, I think. No. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry, we're asking you to solve our particular problems, legacy problems here. But I was wondering if you did have any perspectives, but also to ask you about the right to water as well, and just how states will be mobilising around those issues at COP26, particularly from Global South.
Well, I don't think there's much I can add to the discussion about your transition from oil and gas to more renewable energy. I think that's obviously a conversation that Scotland needs to have. I think the only thing, as someone who's sitting outside of that conversation from my vantage point, I think the issue is always about trade-offs. You've got so many different options of technologies, and the question is, what trade-offs are you willing to incur? As countries, because you do have options in terms of nuclear energy, you do have wind and solar, but they have their trade-offs each, and you need to look at it in terms of the impact some of those options have. I mean, wind and solar have their impacts in terms of the impact they have on endangered species, birds and owls and things like that. Nuclear energy, despite the rap it gets, does have some. There is some evidence that exists that suggests that if you actually compare in terms of the number of deaths per capita, nuclear energy is actually very, very low, despite the bad rap it gets in media. So I think the only thing I could add as a layperson who is looking at this from outside in is, as a country, what trade-offs are you willing to take on board? Because there's no perfect solution. All you have are trade-offs, and you need to decide which one you want, which one you can handle. And the hard part is selling that to your people. That is always the hard part. So we're going down this route. We don't have any other better option. Personally, I give up on the idea of this idea that there's a best option. There's no such thing. There are only trade-offs, and you need to decide what trade-off you're willing to work with as a country. So speaking to the issue of the right to water, I think at the moment, I think somebody asked a question earlier about how the Scottish Government is engaging voices in the Global South around that. My organization, for example, I will be at COP26, not physically. We have actually contributed some inputs to COP26, looking at the issue of right to water in Malawi, what some of the issues are. Of course, looking at the mapping exercise that we did and the value that data is having in terms of government decision making, so that they can have more improved and coordinated implementation of their water and sanitation interventions. So that's what we are doing. But even in the content that we've provided, I emphasize the point that I've made already, that the southern countries like Malawi need to do their part. Scotland has supported the generation of these assets. It's up to Malawi to use those assets, scale those assets, to leverage resources to increase the impact of those assets. So Scotland has done its part, and Malawi, I think, needs to take it forward. And I think at COP26, that's the messaging that my organization and other partners that we collaborate with are making, to say, thank you, Scotland. Now we should take it from here, and this is how we want to do that. So I think that's what I would say in response to your question. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I invite Ms. Boyack to ask her question?
Thanks very much, Convener. In the last session, I asked about the issue of where we are, read the loss and damage pillar of the Paris talks. And it was partly prompted because of a Commonwealth parliamentary presentation I attended, where we had states from the Caribbean talking about the massive impact that they've experienced from regular extreme weather incidents, and where they have no funding to rebuild, leading to climate refugees, you know, horrendous impact. In the last line of the SCIAF submission to us, you've got this question here: how much Scotland pays for adaptation and loss and damage overseas, and how this compared to its fair share of global action based on historical responsibility. Do you want to come in on that, Dr. Hill? What do you think that is? We've got our climate fund, but what more should we be doing in Scotland?
I'm sorry, I cut out there. Is that a question to me?
Yes. You mentioned loss
and
damage.
I completely missed the question. I missed most of the question, but I think I know where you're coming from. Yeah. So, can you hear me okay?
Could we maybe cut Dr. Hill's camera? Because I understand that there's a bit of a problem with the broadband. So could we go to audio only on that, and Sarah, if you want to repeat your question, please.
Okay. In the last session, I asked about the issue of where we are with the loss and damage pillar that was agreed as part of the Paris Agreement 5 years ago. Because recently at a Commonwealth Parliamentary Association event, we had evidence from representatives from the Caribbean who gave us incredible graphic evidence about the impact of the regularity of extreme weather and how it destroys communities. And it's going to lead to climate refugees in the future. So it's to go to the very last point made, Dr. Hill, in your submission, where you say, in assessing Scotland's climate justice credentials, how much Scotland pays for adaptation and loss and damage overseas, and how this compared to the fair share of global action based on historic responsibility. Just as we go to COP26, what should we be saying about that in the discussions on that third pillar of the Paris Agreement?
Sure, thank you. I think as I've said previously, loss and damage has had much less attention within the whole process than it has to have, and I think it is a key issue for the Global South. It certainly was one of the key issues that's discussed at the Glasgow Climate Dialogues, and I think as Jamie mentioned, there was an MP from Bangladesh there who was saying that the Scottish Government should be working with developing countries to establish a solidarity fund to help address loss and damage. I think maybe this also talks to the additionality point that was mentioned earlier, I think, because it's about loss and damage needing to be over and above, you know, the support for adaptation. And it's also about Scotland playing a symbolic role and kind of championing the need for this to be on the agenda and you know, to be really taken seriously at this COP, because in the past it hasn't had the attention that it deserves. So I think basically it's that point. I mean, obviously the Climate Justice Fund is a bit of a drop in the ocean in terms of need if we're talking about adaptation and loss and damage. We're very well aware of that. But we also know that that Scotland can play, you know, can use its soft power and can champion these issues. And I think that's what we would be calling for. I mean, we would like also to see Scotland tax high emitters and polluters and see new and additional forms of finance to help fund both adaptation and loss and damage. But yeah, it's more about the kind of soft power and the symbolic role and pushing for this to be taken seriously.
I think Mr. Shima wants to come in this point, if that's okay.
Excellent, because I'm sure you'd be able to spend that money.
No, thank you very much. I think the comment that was just made about the Climate Justice Fund contribution being a drop in the ocean, yes, that may be the case. But I think the one thing, I want to give a practical example of how that drop in the ocean can actually start a tidal wave, particularly here in my country. During the flooding in 2019, using the database that the Scottish government supported the development of in partnership with the Malawi government, one of the problems we identified was that there were water points that were heavily impacted by the flood, and there was a high risk of contamination to the population. You're looking at about 150,000 people who are at risk of contracting waterborne diseases. And what we did with a small amount of investment from the Scottish government, we were able to leverage more resources from USAID here. But we were able to walk in the door because we had not just the support, but we had the financing from the Scottish government to be able to walk into that door and say, we need this additional financing to actually deal with this problem. And as a result of that, we were able to visit, I believe it was close to 370 water points, did shock chlorination, repaired them, and like I said, 150,000 people now have water because of that investment. But it was a small investment, a drop in an ocean, but it was able to leverage the rest of the ocean. And we were able to bring in other partners to do that. And I think this is where I think Scotland can play a role. I think I heard the figure of 100 billion a year for the next 5 years. I hope your assumption is not that you intend to raise all of that money. But I see Scotland as being an active broker for leveraging or other resources, but also sharing the experience and the ethos of the partnerships that you have on the Climate Justice Fund and the Climate Innovation Fund, which is respect for and listening to the local voices. I think there's a lot that can be shared in you walking into rooms that someone like me can't walk into, where you can influence for changes in, for example, the way, one practical example I think would be the Green Climate Fund, which is the largest climate fund here, which is extremely difficult to access money from. But with your experience working with people from Malawi, Zambia, and Rwanda, and taking that experience and walking into the doors where decisions are made, you can influence for more, I wouldn't say flimsy, but more flexible sort of requirements for people to access that money, especially in times of natural disasters like the flooding in 2019. So Scotland has demonstrated this already by using the little money you bring in to leverage more money. In the case of the flooding, it wasn't planned. It was more impromptu. It was in the moment. But something more structured and coordinated, as mentioned by the professor, would actually be good. That there's a pool of money that's there. And it was proven during the 2019 flooding that the resources are there. It's just a matter of now bringing people together. And I think Scotland can play that role of a broker of other development partners in my country. Thank you.
I think those points are incredibly well made. So I hope you make them when you go to COP virtually. Can I pick exactly those points that are being made with Tazeen Jaffrey? Do you think there will be an appetite if Scotland uses that kind of soft power of examples? Is there an appetite for other countries to begin to address those kind of issues and to pump prime investment and do the education that you talked about very powerfully? Do you think there's a chance of getting that third pillar acted on at the COP26?
I think the issue of loss and damage is now, you know, coming more to the fore. I think it's recognised across the landscape that there's been a lot of attention paid in the previous COPs to mitigation, and a much more direction needs to be paid to adaptation and building resilience. That's coming through quite clear. And to capitalise on that change in direction of travel and focus for COP26, I think there is a lot of opportunity here. I think where we are, where we're positioned with our Climate Justice Fund and what we've managed to do and deliver thus far, it's kind of like building blocks and a pillar for influencing others, such as, for example, the Green Climate Fund, the development banks and others, to build alliances and build bridges across this landscape of climate justice. And climate justice. One thing I would like to add is with loss and damage, though. I think it's that the whole language around how it comes across as well, and this is what I'm hearing in different conversations that I've been having, because loss and damage in itself is about, you know, resources coming in, money spent to build that infrastructure to help people rebuild their lives and so on and so forth. What I'm hearing is that that conversation needs to also move on and embrace and embed how we actually support individuals, human beings, that social and human well-being is really, really important. And bringing what you mentioned earlier about the climate refugee crisis, you know, the projections are incredible. Up to 1.2 billion are at risk of displacement in about, by 2050. And that isn't just about loss and damage. This is about helping people to rebuild their lives as build resilience, because they're losing the value, the worth, the ancestral home, things that they will not be able to recover through loss and damage because it's lost. You see what I mean? Yeah. So I think it's really important that, and again, this is coming through from the World Forum, this fresh thinking around these meaningful dialogues, because the conversation has moved at peace and at pace. And I think the challenge before us is to be very acutely abreast of the climate just conversations across the world and what everyone is asking for. And not just about the funding, but what the funding will actually be used for, yeah. and who will get access to that support. If it's in that bucket of loss and damage, fine, let's make it that. But mm-hmm. there needs to be much more robust thinking around where is it being directed to, how is it being directed, who's going to benefit, how are they going to benefit, and what is it that we want to achieve out of this? And I think that's the big ticket question that I have, is what is it that we want to get out of this, and how is it different from other landscapes around just now, the international development funding landscape? Where is the kind of like the difference, I guess I'm trying to say? How can we position this and then use that to influence others to say, this is where we're heading and would you like to join us?
That's excellent. Thanks very much.
Ms. Minto, did you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. I thought that was a really powerful point there about what we want to achieve with the funding. I'd also like to go back to the education side. I asked the last panel about the transformative power of education and young people being involved in climate change and also climate justice, and what you have learnt, what you've worked with, perhaps in Malawi, connections with young people in Scotland as well. So I'd be interested to know your thoughts on that.
Okay. Could I go to Mr. Shima first?
Thank you very much. I think the issue of young people is becoming more and more important in my country. If you've read Malawi's Vision 2063, it's placing a strong emphasis on young people, and for good reason. I could share some data from the work that we're doing. Some of the work that we're doing in the water sector specifically is looking at whether women and young people actually benefit from water entrepreneurship. Now, interestingly, the data is showing that Both women and young people are disadvantaged in Malawi based on the data we have, but young people are actually 7 times more disadvantaged. So you find that, yes, both are disadvantaged, but young people are extremely disadvantaged. And this is because of their place in rural as well as urban society. In rural communities here, you're only considered an adult if you have your own house. Now, a young person who's 20 years old most likely probably won't have a house, but a young person is kind of stuck in a catch-22. For him to actually have money, he needs to participate in development activities. But most of those development activities are monopolized by the elderly, or those who are much older than themselves, or those who are or married in the rural communities. So you find that they're trapped because they want to get involved, but they're told you can't be involved because you don't have a house. But it's like, but then how can I build a house if I don't get involved? So you see, the young people are sort of stuck in a kind of catch-22. Which is why you have young people who are very disenfranchised. In districts like Mangochi, for example, it is very common for young people to trek to South Africa to look for work, as in many other parts of Malawi, where young people leave Malawi to look for employment elsewhere, because whether in the urban or rural setting, young people don't feel there's a space for them in terms of community or development within urban or rural areas. So this is something that the Malawi government, the current administration, is pushing very, very strongly. And this is something I'm doing personally as well. I am the second oldest person in my office. I am 41 years old. The average age of people in my office is, I think it should be 33 now, because we just hired someone, a 22-year-old. So again, this is what I'm trying to do to get young people to get more involved in the kind of work that we're doing. So I think that's kind of what we're doing. One thing I didn't mention at the beginning is that I'm a board member of the Malawi-Scotland Partnership here. And I'll speak just generally about what the Malawi-Scotland Partnership is doing. They're doing a lot of work trying to engage young people in terms of issues to do with climate change. They've got a young climate champions program, which is supported by the Scottish government, where they're getting young people who are doing exceptional work in environmental protection, working with cook stoves, working with young people to deal with issues of climate change at the local level. And they're trying to promote those voices in other forums together with their sister organization, the Scotland-Malawi Partnership. So that's something that's already going on outside of COP26. And it's a recognition of the fact that young people are the future. It's a cliche to say that, but within the Malawi-Scotland Partnership and the Scotland-Malawi Partnership, that is already happening. And it's young people that are driving it, and it's young people that are at the forefront. And those dinosaurs like ourselves are taking a back seat, so that they are the ones driving the agenda. So that's something I think that's happening in Malawi, in not just the work that I'm doing, but generally, but also through the Scotland-Malawi Partnership effectively. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know if Dr. Hill and Professor Jaffe want to comment very briefly on that. We're now running really tight for time. So, Dr. Hill?
Yeah, just really briefly. So young people were involved in the Climate Challenge Programme Malawi, which we implemented for Scottish Government, and a couple of them are coming to COPs. So if anyone is interested in meeting them, please do let us know. A couple of the young folks are coming. And just to reiterate, the climate literacy stuff and the climate education stuff, we've been doing that both in our work overseas, but also in our work here in schools here, and developing materials for schools here, climate literacy stuff as well. Thanks.
Professor Jaffrey, very briefly, please.
If I could just come in very, very briefly, the transformative power of education. I think with educating our young people, this is not just about primary school children, but this is our adolescents and our older children as well, whether it's in Scotland or overseas. And what I'm seeing and hearing just now is that we're making strides in supporting primary school age children. But when you get to that 12 plus, and dealing with young people of that age, those who are very powerful and can be very powerful agents of change across the education landscape in Scotland, that education on climate change and climate justice is not embedded within the curriculum. And I'm hearing that if you're not taking the relevant subjects at high school, it won't be taught. And nor am I hearing it presented at assemblies or half an hour out for children to learn from that. So I think there's a lot of work that still needs to be done if we want in Scotland to capitalise on the transformative power that education can have of our Scottish young people. And I think a similar kind of like issues across the globe. But what I do want to say on a positive note is that from an education perspective, when I started this journey with developing the centre, it was academically challenging. But now, people from other parts of the world are developing other centres, other groups and others to look at climate change and climate justice, and they're modelling it on the work that we've been doing at the centre. So that is it's a huge privilege that's been happening, but it also tells you how committed the global landscape is to try and get traction to educating people on this subject matter.
We are very tight for time. I've got two members still wishing to ask questions. Going to bring in Mr. Golden first, please.
Thank you, convener. In the interest of time, I'd first of all like to ask a question to Muti and then a separate question to the other panellists. So it's great to hear everything you're doing. I wondered, in terms of Malawi showing climate leadership, if they might become a signatory to the UN Water Courses Convention. I realise you share a lake with Mozambique as well as rivers with other downstream states, and I think that would be brilliant to see. I note that Chad is the most recent signatory to that convention. So any thoughts on that would be welcome. But I also wanted to ask you specifically how you, obviously you have finite resources, how you prioritise both infrastructure for specific water uses, whether it be drinking, sanitation, agriculture or industry, versus flood prevention mechanisms, which you touched upon earlier.
Thank you very much. I think I'll start with your later question, just to see if I've understood it. You're asking how my organisation works within these resources to do the work it does. Is that your question?
Yeah, and how, you know, there could be, you know, competing, you know, do you put in flood prevention mechanisms or do you prioritise putting in a water point? How do you make those decisions on the ground?
Oh, okay, fine. No, thank you. Well, I think one of the things that we are trying to do as an organisation is to try to promote what we call water demand balance, which is basically a methodology that's, you go into an area and you try to understand how much water is being taken out and how much water is coming in. Is there a deficit or is there a surplus? If there's a deficit, that will tell you that you need to invest in some kind of managed aquifer recharge or some way of recharging the groundwater, right? But if there's a surplus, it's now an issue of how can that water be maximized for maybe sustainable agriculture or other things. And this is something the Climate Justice Innovation Fund has helped. So using data is extremely important, and working with experts who know how to do that is something that would help with that particular issue. Using data to understand what is the water situation, that will inform how we invest that money. Going to the first question, I can't speak for the Maori government, but I do know that some of the work that we've been doing with the University of Strathclyde is feeding, is contributing to having a better understanding of the transboundary relationships that Malawi has with its neighbours. Because I think you all know the complicated relationship that we have with our neighbours when it comes to the lake. And then on top of that, our intention to actually tap water from the lake to Lilongwe, which also has impacts for our transboundary relationships. Now, I'm not privy to the discussions that have taken place around that, but it is, I have been in discussions or forums where I have echoed my sentiments, which is that the Malawi government needs to be very careful and really talk to its neighbours to really understand what are the transboundary issues from a technical, political and geopolitical perspective before it makes any decisions. So that's what I could say to that.
Thank you. That was incredibly insightful. To the rest of the panel, and I'll start perhaps with Geraldine, but just the same question. Thinking about Scotland's role on the world stage, I note in your submission that you have said that with reference to the Climate Change Act, the credibility of the Act appears to be wearing thin, and for Scotland to be meaningfully regarded as a climate leader, it's essential that there's a step change in action. I just wondered, you know, your general thoughts on that area.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's with specific reference to the mitigation efforts, to be honest, and the fact that the targets have been missed in the last 3 years. So, yeah, that was in relation to that. Sorry, what was the second part of your question?
That was all.
That was it. Just your thoughts on it.
Answered.
Okay. The additionality thing that was mentioned earlier, that was to do with climate finance, and it was to do with the need for climate finance to be additional to the A budget, basically. That was what that point was about.
Okay. Have you got a question for Professor Jaffrey?
Just if she's got any specific thoughts on Scotland as a climate leader and versus the failure to meet the targets.
Very, very briefly, Professor Jaffrey, if you don't mind that.
Yeah, no, I think we have a valuable contribution to make. Despite the fact that we've not made our targets, we are making good strides collectively in other areas, and we have a very strong role and contribution to play. The only my only suggestion would be is to be very when we place ourselves on that world stage, is being crystal clear as to what it is that we are contributing with reference to our climate justice approach, and how it's very clearly different from just the stage of development. What's the added value that we're bringing to the global platform? Because I think that is what's going to give Scotland a lot of traction and get others to follow suit.
Dr. Allen?
Thank you. I'll address my question too, if I get away with it, purely to Mr. Lema, and it was really just to ask if he can give some indication to people watching who perhaps don't realise this, but just how dramatically the landscape in Malawi has changed over the last 40 years. Deforestation was mentioned. All these problems are connected.
Yeah.
I know that when I was in Malawi, two ladies came up to me and very politely but very forcefully pointed out that I had come in a car and they had to walk an extra 2 miles every day to get water, and there was a connection between the two things. All these things are connected, but perhaps you can give some indication of how the landscape has changed.
Thank you. I probably can't speak to the land question. I'm not a land specialist, but I will speak from the water perspective, just so that people understand. I think if you use there's a piece of data called renewable water. This is the amount of water per person per year, right? Very simply. And if you go on the World Bank website, they actually have a graph that shows you how much water, renewable water, that comes to Malawi per person per year. And if you look at it, of course, the graph is like that. But what people don't know is that the amount of water per person per year, I think it's now about 900 cubic meters per person per year or something like that. It's almost the same as Morocco, which is a country that's in the middle of a desert. And a lot of that is partly because of population growth. We've grown substantially. But what is also exacerbating that is the degradation of the environment. Now, what that does is you don't have any vegetative cover, so water erodes the surface of the land, and that leads to siltation in rivers. Rivers go dry. As someone who's working in the groundwater sector, I have seen some data from one water monitoring well. There are several monitoring wells across Malawi, so I want to emphasize this, where the water table was dropping on average a meter per year. That is the impact in one particular area of Malawi. So that's the impact that mismanagement of the environment is having on the water resources. They are dwindling. And this is not me saying this. Even the ministry, the line ministry responsible for water affairs, has publicly come out and said Malawi is drying up. And because of that, we need to invest in approaches that make sure that the water that we do have is conserved and protected. And part of that is going to involve more investment in improving and increasing vegetative cover. So I can speak from the water perspective. I wish I did have at my fingertips the data for the cover, but I would encourage people to go on Google Earth and see how the greenery disappears over time. Then they could appreciate the impact. It is quite substantial. And it's having a knock-on effect, which is why I said, yes, I can tell Scotland, what are you doing about climate justice? But that's why I emphasize, what is Malawi doing about environmental? We have our part to play as well.
And
thank you.
Very finally, also, Mr. Talema, you mentioned that the population, or the average age of population in Malawi is young. You mentioned issues about accountability and promoting accountability. I know that the Scotland-Malawi Partnership and the Malawi-Scotland Partnership work together on these issues in both Scotland and Malawi. But can you offer some perspective or predictions on how you feel this is all going to develop in the future as that generation comes to the fore? Will they have new ideas about accountability? Will they have new expectations about accountability? And what can we do together to work through those issues?
Well, I don't want to be a prophet, but I think last year nobody... Well, I think last year nobody could have predicted that Malawi would have had a rerun of the election. Nobody, not even me. So I think anything is... Malawi is a small giant. It's capable of doing big things when it puts its mind to it. So I think my prediction is, if I can go by the young people I have in my office and the quality of young people, the things they talk about, the things they think about, the way they challenge me as a leader, I think the future is bright. But there have to be deliberate efforts to actually involve young people. Because I think the real crisis with young people is that they're underutilized. So you have all this knowledge and all this energy that is not being maximized to actually develop the country. And it's quite saddening that you have students who have graduated and they can stay 5 years without being employed. If I could share my screen, I could show you emails I get from young people asking for internships with me and they don't want to be paid. But I'm like, I can't just hire you for nothing. So there's this hunger to contribute and there's no outlets for them to do that. So with the new administration, I've seen a more willingness to engage young people. It's in the strategy, and I'm hoping that they'll live up to it. And if they do, and that willingness to engage young people meets the enthusiasm of young people, I hope for a better future. Like I said, we didn't think we were going to have a rerun of elections last year. I think Malawi will do better if we utilise the resource of young people that we have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Shema, Professor Jaffrey and Dr. Hill, thank you very much for your contributions this morning. I'm going to quickly finish today's proceedings and move into private session. Thank you for everyone for their attendance.